save now, I beseech thee, O Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, send now prosperity. God is the Lord which hath showed us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords, even under the horns of the altar. O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Shall we pray? Lord, we do give thanks to you today for your goodness and for your mercy towards us. Lord, as we have gathered together, we pray that even now there will be a special work of your Holy Spirit within our lives as he prepares us for an understanding of the Word and as he ministers to us of the truth of the Word of God. Lord, bless your people as we have gathered, Lord, to wait upon you, to seek your face and your will, to experience again your touch and your strength. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. As we move this week into the second chapter of the book of Acts, we find the growing hostility by the religious leaders against Jesus Christ. Mark will give to us several little incidents, and in each incident, he will show this negative spirit towards Jesus that is developing among the religious leaders. And so as you read through Mark chapter 2 this afternoon, it will be good for you to note the growing and the rising animosities against Jesus. This is what we read about in Psalm 118, where the prophecy concerning Jesus declared that the stone which was set of naught by the builders, they are going to seek to set Jesus at naught. They will crucify him. In fact, in chapter 3, the first little episode that we see, the healing of the man with the withered hand in the synagogue. After that experience, we read in verse 6, and the Pharisees went forth and immediately took counsel with the Herodians against Jesus, how they might destroy him. So very early in the ministry of Christ, these religious forces were combining. Now, the Herodians and the Pharisees were constantly at each other. They were enemies of each other, but they were brought together by their common hatred of Jesus. And so they got together and began to form a plan whereby they could set at naught the stone. So, as we look at Mark chapter 2 this morning, verse 13, again we see the attitude of the Pharisees as they are expressing it towards Jesus. Jesus went forth again by the seaside, and all of the multitude had resorted unto him, and he taught them. And as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus. He was sitting at the receipt of custom. He was a custom inspector. He collected taxes from the goods that were brought into the city. And he said unto Levi, follow me. And he arose and followed him. And it came to pass that as Jesus sat at meat in his house, that many publicans and sinners sat also together with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many, and they followed him. When Matthew or Levi was called of Jesus to follow him, and he realized, I'm leaving this old life, I'm going to have now a new relationship with God through Jesus. I'm going to follow him. He decided to throw one last big party for the old crowd. The other tax collectors with whom he was friends, and also the sinners. And a big crowd of them gathered together, and Jesus was invited by Matthew in order that he might introduce Jesus to these publicans and sinners. And we read, when the scribes and the Pharisees saw him eating with the publicans and sinners, you see, here they are, they're lurking there. They said unto his disciples, how is it that he eats with and drinks with publicans and sinners? And when Jesus heard it, he said unto them, they that are whole need not the physician, but those that are sick. I didn't come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. This critical attitude towards Jesus had begun. Be careful of a critical attitude. It is something that seems to develop. Once you start looking at things critically, in a condemning way, in a judging way, it seems like you begin to get in a critical mode where you start to criticize anything and everything. You begin to find fault. You begin to judge. And what happens is that you become so critical that people no longer pay attention to what you say, because you've come to criticize everything and anything, so that no longer do people even pay attention. They say, oh, he's just the most critical person. He's always, you know, critical and judgmental. And people soon don't really listen to you anymore because they realize that you've got that bent in your character now that just sort of disallows what you say anymore as far as people are concerned. But there was a certain degree in which the scribes and Pharisees were justified in their feeling of criticism of Jesus eating and drinking with the publicans and the sinners. For in the first psalm, we are told, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way with sinners. And here is Jesus joining in a feast with the sinners. In Proverbs, we read, my son, if sinners entice you, consent not to it. If they say, come with us, let us lay wait for blood, let us lurk privately for the innocent without cause. Let us swallow them up alive as the grave and whole as those that go down to the pit. We'll find all kinds of precious substance. We'll fill our house with spoil. Cast your lot among us. Let us all have one purse. My son, walk not thou in the way with them. Refrain thy foot from their path, for their feet run to evil, and they make haste to shed blood. Bad company has been the downfall of many a person. And many times a person, under the peer pressure of a group, will do things that they really don't want to do. But the peer pressure becomes so strong, they succumb. And though they don't want to do it, though they really are trying to resist, they cannot resist the peer pressure. And many a person has been led into drug use and many other vices just as the result of hanging around with sinners and then being pressured by that peer pressure to join them in their activities. And thus there was a certain modicum of justification in their condemning Jesus for eating and drinking with the publicans and the sinners. The publicans were tax collectors. They were hated by the Jews because they were considered to be collaborators with Rome. They were looked upon as being guilty of treason because they were cooperating and collecting taxes for Rome. They were hated in the community because most of them were crooked. They were known to be crooked. They would charge exorbitant taxes, but they had the power of the Roman government behind them, and if you refused to pay, they could confiscate your property, and they would often do that, and thus they were hated bitterly by the Jews. To see Jesus eating with these men was offensive, and invited also to the party were many sinners. Now, in those days, in that culture, they considered eating with a person equivalent to becoming one with that person, an identity with that person. You see, eating in those days was not with nice table settings like you have, your china and nice forks and spoons, but it was eating with your hands. You didn't have nice sliced bread, but you had just loaves of bread on the table. You didn't have separate bowls for your soup, but you had one central bowl for your soup. You didn't have little salad plates. You had the salad in little plates in the middle of the table. And they would pass around the loaf of bread, and you would pull off a part of the bread, and then you would dip it in the soup, and you'd eat it, and you'd dip it back in the soup and eat some more. But everybody else was dipping in the same soup. Everybody else was dipping in the same sauces. And thus there was a commingling of germs, as well as eating from the same loaf and drinking the soup from the same bowl. So their minds, and in their minds, they saw that as really becoming one with each other. Because the bread that I am eating is from the same loaf of bread that you're eating. I broke off a piece, you broke off a piece. And so I am being nourished by the same bread that is nourishing you. That bread is being assimilated and is becoming a part of my body. But it's also being assimilated by you and becoming a part of your body. And thus, mystically, we're becoming a part of each other. And they looked on it that way. That is why an Orthodox Jew would never eat with a Gentile. He didn't want to have anything to do with the Gentile becoming one with him, nor would he eat with a sinner. Now, these Pharisees are the fellows who, when they walked down the street, would wrap their robe tightly around them and hold their robes tight to their body, lest their robe, in flinging to the side as they were walking, would brush against a sinner. They wanted nothing to do with the sinners. And here is Jesus sitting there partying with sinners and with publicans. And they're shocked that Jesus would mix with such a crowd, become one with them, sort of almost identifying with them. Now Jesus responded to their criticism by saying, those that are whole do not need a physician, but those that are sick. He admitted that he was in sick company, men with sick minds and sick humor. But they were the people that he had come to seek and to save. In fact, the Bible tells us of another publican, tax collector, who lived in Jericho, whose name was Zacchaeus. And he was curious about this man Jesus, of whom he had heard so much. And so when he heard that Jesus was coming down the street, he ran ahead of the crowd, climbed up into a tree, because he wanted to see Jesus. Now, he didn't join the crowd because he didn't dare to join the crowd. Tax collectors were so hated that if he gets in a crowd, he gets pinched, he gets elbowed, he gets shoved until he comes out black and blue. So he has to climb a tree. He's safely above the crowd, but at least he can look down and see Jesus. To his amazement, Jesus came right to the tree where he had found his perch, looked up and said, Zacchaeus, come on down. I want to come to your house today. I want you to feed me. And they were shocked that Jesus would go and eat with a publican. And it was then that Jesus said, I have come to seek and to save that which was lost. And thus, Jesus declared, I didn't come to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance. The word repentance means to change. I didn't come to change the righteous. I came to change the sinners. It's one thing to keep company with sinners, to be a part of the gang. But it's quite another thing to be in their midst in order to bring to them the light of God's love. We have a pastor in Bradford, England, Jim King, who spends Friday and Saturday night in the pubs. He goes down there amongst the crowd that is drinking, and he spends the whole evening drinking Cokes and just witnessing to these people as they're getting drunk. He has been doing this for so many years now that on Christmas Eve, they shut the bar down at 10 o'clock and let him take over and have a Christmas Eve service for all of those that are there in the pub. But he is there as a light. He is not there to participate in the drinking, but he's there to show them a better way and to lead them to Jesus Christ. And so Jesus was eating with the publicans and the sinners in order that he might heal, in order that he might call them to repentance. As a Christian, you cannot escape being in the world. Unfortunately, that's the environment in which we must live. I have to admit that many times in my mind, I mentally escape. I look around at our society and I see how it is just falling apart. I don't think that any of us have been untouched by the corruption of our society. Things are stolen. People are injured and drive by senseless shootings, and the whole society is just falling apart, and it's sometimes in my mind I think, I can't take this much longer. Lord, I wish that we could form a Christian community someplace. I wish that we were sort of like our pilgrim fathers, that we could go to some unchartered territory and we could start over afresh. We could live in an environment where we didn't have to buy locks for our doors. We could live in a loving Christian environment where everybody loves each other and we take care of each other and we watch over each other and we're concerned for each other's needs. Where we would be willing to just pitch in and help when anyone is in trouble. Where there would be no need for police forces or jails, and we could save really so much we wouldn't have to charge taxes because we wouldn't need all of these services. And we could write a constitution that would be so foolproof that in years to come, Supreme Court justices could not change the whole intent and meaning by messing it up. And in my mind, I take all of you with me and we escape to Shangri-La. And we live together in that beautiful environment. But such is not to be. Well, before long, I am going to be moving to such a community where there is neither sorrow, suffering, nor tears. God will wipe away all tears from their eyes. They'll sorrow no more. No more pain. But in the meantime, I'm living in this world, and God has ordained it to be. But we're sort of like a ship, which is designed and made to be in the water. And it doesn't hurt a ship to be in the water. It only becomes dangerous when you get water in the ship. And God has designed and ordained that we should be in this world, and the world can't hurt us unless the world gets in us, and then we're in trouble. Jesus, when he prayed for us, he prayed, "Father, I don't ask that you take them out of this world, but that you would just keep them from the evil." That's his prayer for you. Not that the Father would take you out of the world, that the Father will just keep you from the evil that is in the world. Now, why would Jesus eat with publicans and sinners? Of course, he told us plainly. He was there as a physician to heal the sick. He was there to call the sinners to repentance. It is interesting to me that Jesus was willing to do the unconventional. In the last story that we had in chapter 1 of Mark, you remember it was the story of the man with leprosy who came to Jesus and said, "Lord, if you willed, you could make me clean." And Jesus looked with compassion upon him, and it said, and he touched him and said, "I will, be thou clean." People were afraid to touch lepers. Jesus wasn't afraid to touch him in order to heal him. People did not want to associate with sinners. Jesus did not fear associating with sinners if he could lead them to repentance, to the better life. And so Jesus was there eating with them in order that he might bring them to the higher level of life, that life in Christ. But God said something interesting concerning Jesus when Paul was writing by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to the Corinthians. He said, "For God hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God through him. God laid on Jesus all of our sins. He was sinless. He was pure. But God laid upon him our sins in order that the prophecy of Isaiah might be fulfilled when he said, all of us like sheep have gone astray. We did it our own way. And God laid on him the iniquities of us all. And down there in verse 11 of chapter 53, he said, and he shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By the knowledge of him shall my righteous servant Jesus justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. So Jesus was to be identified with sin in even a greater way, in that he was to take your sin and my sin, and he was to become what we are in order that he might make us what he is. He became sin for us, took the punishment of our sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God through him. He became what I am, that I might become what he is. And beloved, now are we the sons of God. It doesn't yet appear what we're going to be, but we know when he appears, we're going to be like him, for we shall see him as he is. For as many as received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, even to those who believed on his name. And so here we see him identifying with sinners, eating with sinners, becoming one in that sense, in order that they might become one in his righteousness. The story demonstrates that Jesus is not afraid to come down to your level in order that he might lift you from that level into a higher level. As bad or as unrighteous as you may be, he's willing to eat with you if through that he can lift you out of your sin. He isn't afraid of touching you in order to make you clean. People have developed wrong notions concerning Jesus. As we get into Mark chapter 3 next week, the very first little vignette that he gives to us has to do with Jesus coming to the synagogue in Capernaum on the Sabbath day. And it happens that on this Sabbath day, there was a man in the synagogue with a withered hand. So that as Jesus came into the synagogue, they all looked at him to see if he would heal this man on the Sabbath day. Now it is interesting that the enemies of Jesus, when he came into the synagogue, knew instinctively that the person in the synagogue that would draw the attention of Jesus and he would be most interested in was the man in the synagogue that had the greatest need. They knew that instinctively. They immediately related Jesus to the man with the greatest need. So often we think of Jesus as not being at all interested in us because our need is so great. You know, he'd like to hang out with Billy Graham. He wouldn't want to hang out with me, you know. But it is interesting that the Lord is interested this morning. And I believe he's here today because he said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, I will be there in the midst. And the Lord is gathered with us this day. And do you know who he is most interested in this morning? The person who is here, who has the greatest need. He's interested in you. Always to the end, that he might remove the blight from your life and make you whole. He's the physician. He's interested in healing the sick. He's interested in the sinner to call them to repentance, to change, to know that new life in him. We have such a wonderful high priest, one who is representing us to God. He is a high priest who is touched by the feelings of our weaknesses, because he in all points was tempted just like we are. And because we have this high priest, even Jesus Christ, we can come boldly to the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace and help in our time of need. In Hebrews 7:25, the author said, "Wherefore he is able also to save unto the uttermost those who will come unto God by him." Let me tell you something. You haven't sunk so low that Jesus isn't willing to come down and to sit with you there to lift you out. He is able to save to the uttermost all who will come unto God by him. Billy Sunday, an evangelist of yesteryear, quite a dramatic evangelist, was saved from a life of alcoholism. He was a drunk. And so he used to say, "He is able to save to the guttermost." He said, I spent many nights in the gutter drunk. And he is able to save to the guttermost all who will come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such a high priest became us, who is holy and harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. Such a high priest. He's separate from sinners. He can mix with sinners, but he's always separate from them. But he mixes with them in order that he might bring them with him into the highest heavens. Reaches down to touch you in order to transform your life and make you fit for the kingdom of God. Such is our Lord, who is here today to touch that person with the greatest need. He's willing to be there with you. He said, "I stand at the door and knock. And if any man will hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and I'll have supper with you. I'll become one with you. I'll sit down and eat with you. I'm not afraid of you. I'm not afraid of being soiled by you. I'm willing to mix with you in order that I might bring you healing and help, new life." Such is our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for our Lord and our Savior, one who was willing to empty himself, come in the form of a man, as a servant obedient unto death, even the death of the cross, came down to the bottom, to the lowest. He mixed with the sinners, the publicans, but he brought them up into a new life, a new relationship with you. Oh, Lord, we thank you that you're not afraid to touch us in order to make us clean. Touch us this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Shall we stand? Today, if you need the touch of the Lord upon your life, I'd encourage you to go back to the prayer room. Pastors and counselors will be there to pray with you and to lead you to a real walk with God, lifting you out of the miry clay, getting your life established on the solid rock. May the Lord be with you and bless you. Pray that He'll give you a glorious week, just filling you with His love, with His goodness, with His mercies and His grace. Don't forget to pray for the Harvest Crusade this week, Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday night at the Jack Murphy Stadium in San Diego. We're praying that God will do a similar work down there that He did in Anaheim Stadium. And so we appreciate your prayers for the crusade this coming weekend, seeing what God is going to do. Pray for us as during the week we'll be up at the camp with the junior high school kids and looking forward to God's Spirit working in their lives there in that beautiful environment up at the campgrounds. But may this just again be one of those glorious banner weeks of an overflowing cup as God just fills our lives until we overflow with His love and with His grace, imparting that love and grace to a world filled with sin in which we live. The Lord bless thee,
Lord bless thee,
and keep thee.
And keep thee.
The Lord make
His face to shine upon thee, and be gracious unto thee, and be gracious unto thee.
On behalf of The Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact The Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.